My friends, I want to talk to you today as you're finding your seats. I know that people have had different kinds of weeks. Some of them weren't so good. Some of them maybe had some busted pipes, some car trouble. But I think in addition to that, some people maybe just had a tougher year. You've had some real tough stuff. And I want to challenge you and encourage you, no matter how bad things get, you've got to decide that you're going to have a positive attitude, that you're going to go ahead and trust God, that you're going to go ahead and believe God, that you're going to go ahead and obey God, and you're going to get through this thing on to the other side. Yeah. Today, we're going to talk about the promise that's in the pattern. There's a pathway that we need to take to the promise, but it's inside the pattern that we're going to study. We're going to look at a pattern of the Old Testament. And everybody needs this because everybody goes through hard times. Whatever you're going through today, can I just tell you, man, I get it. Life is tough. There's hard things out there. Early on in Kenzie's and my marriage, we had a bunch of hard stuff. Like, our marriage was good, but life was hard. There were just different things that happened when we were in our early 20s. There's a lot of dreams that we thought were going to come to pass right away, and they didn't. And, you know, we had a lot of challenges financially. We had a lot of challenges in terms of what we had access to, the connections we had access to. We didn't have any kind of headquarters for the things that we wanted to do. And then I got sick, and so I didn't even have access to health. And it wasn't like you got a little sick. It was like you got so sick you had to quit working for 4.5 years. It was bad. There was a bunch of stuff that didn't quite go right. And during that time, Kenzie and I both had to keep just putting one foot in front of the other every day and saying, it doesn't matter if it's not perfect, I've got to go ahead and believe that God is still good and God still has good plans. And just because things are going one way in one season doesn't mean that's how they're going to go in the next season. So we're going to look at a few patterns today. How many are already feeling strong, man? We got to get this today. No matter how bad it gets, and I know we can get discouraged. We're like, well, you know, is it ever going to be better? Is it ever going to be some, you know, day when we don't have to be dealing with stuff all the time? I've got this trouble over here, and this person is yelling at me over here, and grandma wants more gambling money over here, and I can't get rid of this addiction. I just made that up. My grandma doesn't want more gambling money. But whatever it is, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's just stuff that is not ideal. It's not perfect. It's not where I thought we would be. Maybe feel even a little bit behind. So we're going to look at the promise that's in the pattern, and let me show you the pattern, okay? We're going to look at it on the board in just a second, but here's the pattern. You get into something that's ridiculously hard, like it's impossible. There's no way for you to get out. You can't see any way to get through it. And then you're faithful and you're obedient, and one day, just at the right time, boom, God gets you out. And you're just out, and you didn't know how you were going to get out, but suddenly you are out. And you're like, wow, I didn't even see that coming. And then it's a little better. Like, you're in a little better position, but then there's things that aren't perfect, and things aren't all going right, and things aren't what you thought they would be. And so you're in this impossible situation that you can't get out of, and you decide, I'm just going to go ahead and obey, and I'm going to go ahead and purify myself, and then one day, boom, you're into a whole new level, and everything's fine. That is the pattern. Here's the pattern on the board. You're in a wilderness of sorts, and I'll explain all this in a minute. You're in a wilderness, things are difficult, things aren't perfect, and you come up to a place where, man, it's just impossible, I can't cross this thing, I can't get past this thing, and then one day God just shows the way, and boom, you get over into the promised land. Let me go to Romans chapter 15, because verse 4, the Apostle Paul is writing to the Romans, and he wants even the Christians of those times to understand something that we need to understand, and that is that if we're smart, we'll look back in the past because we'll see patterns back there. Well, even though we're under a different covenant, as we look at the way God related to his people under the old covenant, if we'll look at that, he says, you'll learn some things. You'll learn some things about how God does things that you can apply to your own life. So he says, Romans 15:4, for whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction. Somebody say, it's for me. So that through perseverance, there's the first one. You gotta keep going. Don't you dare quit now. Perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures. Oh, I'm going to need some Bible. Good thing somebody got a reading plan at the beginning of the year. I'm going to need some Bible. Got to stay in there. We might have hope. We might have hope if we endure it, if we stay in the scriptures, if we look to the past for the patterns, we're going to have hope. Hope's a powerful word, man. We need some hope today. I'll tell you, and this is just for for nerdy fanboys like me, but all I need to do is hear Princess Leia say, "You're my only hope," and I'll go into tears, man. That's real. Yeah. Because we just need hope, man. Life is hard, and we need hope, and so we're going to look back in the past to try to understand this. So Deuteronomy 12, or 1, verse 2, you've got it there in your notes. I'm just going to summarize it for you. Here's the thing. The Israelites, they came out of Egypt, and they were supposed to go into the Promised Land. Okay, so here's Egypt. Sorry if y'all can't see it over there. Use your imagination. There's Egypt over here. That's my little pyramid. And they get out of Egypt, and they were in slavery. So, like, they're already in a better position. It's not perfect, but it's way better than it was. But because of unbelief, because of unfaithfulness to the Lord, through the various tests that they got, so they got a test of, are you going to trust me for water? They got a test of, are you going to trust me for food? Are you going to trust me to go into the Promised Land? And they, you know, they failed all those tests. God was still faithful to them, but they failed those tests. And so to punish them, God let them be in the desert wandering around for 40 years. We're going to read about it in a little bit. It's going to be pretty scary. But they're wandering around in the wilderness. And what Deuteronomy 1:2 says is that even though it was only an 11-day trip, dude, it was supposed to be 11 days. But they just meandered and wandered around in the desert. They never got to where they were supposed to go until an entire generation of people died off. Now, here's what happens to you and I. Maybe we get out of slavery to sin. We come to Jesus Christ. That's kind of like what getting out of Egypt is like. We come to Jesus Christ, and then we get into this place of wilderness. We're wandering around. We don't know what we're doing or where we're going. We're trying to make progress. We're trying to get to the better situation that we're aiming at. But instead, we keep getting these refining little tests. And I made them green because they're good for you. These little tests are good for you. See, we all need to grow in resolve. We all need to grow in Christ-likeness. We all need to grow in selflessness. And that's what these tests are designed to draw out. Sometimes, my friends, we need to decide that we're just going to be faithful in the midst of the mundane. There's a lot of mundanity in following Jesus Christ. Just so you know, sorry, it's not just all one big concert. There's a lot of mundane stuff. So here's what the great potter does. Okay, the potter, that's God. We're the little clay in his hand. He puts us on his potter's wheel. All right, and it's a great thing. Oh man, he's the potter and I'm the clay. Ooh, he's gonna shape me. But then he puts us on the wheel and just starts whipping us around. Okay, we're just whipping. You know, right? And we're just going, what is going on? Why? Like, and nothing changes. Like, we're just going, man, it's the same dumb room. I'm not making any progress. What is this guy doing? All I do, it's the same thing again and again and again. We're like, God, what are you doing? Because it looks to us like you're not making any progress. You're not getting anywhere. But what we don't understand is God's doing something on the inside. He's shaping us. He's rubbing away some rough edges that need to come out before we get to that better promised land. And so he's rubbing that stuff out, and he's getting rid of some of our selfishness. He's doing this kind of thing. But to us, it just feels mundane. Like, why do I keep having these same stupid tests? Nothing ever changes. Honey, he's getting you ready. See, here's the thing. Even though these feel like detours, these little tests here in the wilderness, they feel like detours, but what we need to understand is that God is the designer of the detours. He keeps us in his will and designs little detours because there's stuff he's got to draw out of us before he can take us any deeper. Is anybody understanding this today? So they take 40 years, essentially, to get even to the edge of this river. Now, this river is the Jordan River, and it's right before the Promised Land. Okay? So we need to understand what this river means. It's a literal river. The Jordan River is a literal river. But it's so important in the Bible. Scholars tell us that it even represents boundaries in general. Okay? And you've heard this. I'm going over Jordan. I'm going over home. I'm a poor wayfaring stranger. You all have heard that old spiritual song. It's in a lot of spirituals about the Jordan is kind of like my passage into heaven because heaven is the true promised land. And heaven is the true promised land, but it also just in general represents boundaries in our lives that once we finally get past, we come into a greater land. It's not a perfect land. It's not heaven, but even the promised land wasn't heaven. The promised land was good. It was flowing with milk and honey for these Israelites, but dude, they still had like battles to fight. They still, real people had to die. They really had, you know, tribal warfare. They really had just problems that they ultimately needed to solve. So the promised land wasn't perfect, and our little promised lands as we go aren't perfect, but they are things that God holds out before us, and he says, I want you to get this. I want you to have this, but I'm not going to give it to you right away because I've got some shaping to do. I've got to keep you stirring yourself up and resolve to take hold of Christ, because that's how the promises really come to pass in our lives. So let's start in Joshua 1:2. Now they've done it. Okay, so Joshua's here. He's right here on the edge of the promised land in front of the Jordan with all of God's people. Chapter 1, verse 1, after the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come. That's important. See, God chooses the time. God informed Joshua, hey man, it wasn't the time 5 years ago, it wasn't 25 years ago, it wasn't 30 years ago, it wasn't 6 days ago, it wasn't 3 hours ago, it's now. God says, now is the time, Joshua. It's my anointed time, my appointed time. And sometimes the purpose of us being on that wheel is for us just to die to self and die to our timing. See, real faith is patient. Real faith is patient. Real faith understands whenever, man. It really doesn't matter. God is the one who does it. So it can happen whenever, and I'm cool with that because I trust him. The time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan into the land that I am giving them. That's the promised land. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set your foot, you will be on land I have given you. Now, we might think of the Jordan as, man, that's not really an impressive river. We have more impressive rivers than that right here in the United States. And I think that's true. And in most seasons, it's not particularly an impressive river, but the writer in Joshua goes deliberately in verse 15 to point out that it was in flood stage. So this was not the normal stage. The time has come, the Lord says, I've led you up to this bank of this river while it's in flood stage so that I can show forth my power on your behalf. I've got a little video. I think this was taken in 2015. Let's see what the Jordan looks like when it's in flood stage. To a people that rolls up to that thing, okay, and they've got all their stuff, right? So you might say, wow, how do they build some rafts or whatever? Dude, you have all your livestock. For the past 40 years, you've had stuff. You've got tents, and it's not like there's mansions across the stream there, right? They're going to have to do stuff after that. So they got to get all their equipment, everything over there. They got to get their little kids over this thing. So they're looking at this thing, and this is scary. And Jordan's for us, those barriers in our lives, they can look very scary. How are we going to get across this thing? And here's the encouragement that we've got to know. There's almost always a Jordan before the promised land. There's almost always a Jordan. There's some barrier. And it's often a barrier of fear or some circumstance you can't get past. There's some Jordan before the promised land. But the good news is when you are on the bank of the Jordan, you should be getting ready for a breakthrough because that's what's about to happen for the Israelites. So Joshua 3:1. Early the next morning, Joshua and all the Israelites left Acacia Grove and arrived at the banks of the Jordan River, where they camped before crossing. So they're right on the bank there. And my friends, I need us to understand like what this is. This was a physical land, but for us in every one of our spiritual stories, it represents not only the perfect heaven, but it represents something better than right now. Someplace that God is trying to get us toward. Maybe it's like one-upping our relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe it's going a little bit deeper with him. Maybe it's some promise that you've really been believing for. Maybe it's you breaking forth into a brand new season of fruitfulness. Maybe it is you finally getting that promotion that you really believe God was telling you to pray for. Maybe it means you finally break through in that relationship where you were having difficulty. Whatever it is, there's always something we've got to break through to get to a better land, a promised land. And we know we're still going to face challenges in the promised land. It's just going to be in some ways better like it was for the Israelites. Verse 2, 3 days later, the Israelite officers went through the camp giving these instructions to the people. So, okay, we're going to get the instructions now. Here's what I want you to do, people. When you see the Levitical priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, okay, so this is the box that these Levitical priests, these really set apart priests, they're the only ones who can touch this thing. They're carrying this box around, and in this box was the Ten Commandments and a little bit of manna, but also on top of the box there was these cherubim that surrounded what was really understood as the presence of God itself. There it was, and ultimately this would end up in the tabernacle, in the temple, and they're supposed, it's so holy that, man, you can't even really get too near it. Only these guys can touch it. And it's going to go first. How many saw Raiders of the Lost Ark? Remember that last scene there? That's why only Levites could touch the Ark, okay? Because you might get your face melted if you mess with the holiness of God. Remember, in this epoch, God is gracious, but he's also demonstrating to his people he is holy other than us. He is holy, and so we're not to take him lightly. He's a big doggone deal. Let me say it a different way. Jesus is both a lion and a lamb, and what we do to our detriment often is we try to make him one or the other. He's only powerful and almost frightening, or he's only gentle. Baby, he's so beautiful, impossible for us to understand. He's both at the same time, and he's always good, and he's always looking actually out for us. Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, move out from your positions and follow them. Since you've not traveled this way before, they will guide you. Stay about a half a mile behind them, keeping clear distance between you and the ark. Make sure you don't come any closer. Why? So you don't get your face melted. Then Joshua told the people, here it goes, he says, purify yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do great wonders among you. Purify yourself. In the morning, Joshua said to the priests, lift up the ark and lead the people across the river. And so they started out and went ahead of the people with the presence of God going first, the presence of God going first. Verse 8, give this command to the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant. When you reach the banks of Jordan River, take a few steps into the river and stop. Now, they're looking at this thing, man. They got this thing. You know, they're carrying this. They get up to the edge. Ah, this is scary. There's no ferry coming. Like, what are we going to do now? How's God going to get us through this? Verse 10, Joshua said, by this, it's an important verse, shall you know the living God is among you, and he will assuredly dispossess before you the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Hivite, the Perizzite, the Girgashite, the Amorite, and the Jebusites. All those ites are in here. Okay? So he just told them two things. He said, first, guys, here's what I'm about to do, a miracle. I'm about to part this water, and it's going to be awesome. And you're going to be saying, like, oh my gosh, God is with us, just like in the old times, hallelujah. But something else is supposed to happen. What also is supposed to happen is, it's supposed to communicate a message to you about the future. Because all these ites haven't happened yet. These are battles that are to come. These are real trials that these people are really going to have to go through in order to get a fuller experience of their promised land. And God says, just like I do this right now, I'm going to be faithful then. He says, here's what you should learn when you see God show up awesomely in your life. You should learn God is awesome and God is with me, but also, and God will be faithful in the future just like he is right now, because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Okay? So we're supposed to be learning about God. Hey, I've almost got some Holy Ghost moxie. I've also almost got some Jesus audacity. That means when I roll up in the future on some ites, okay, I'm being, look, man, I remember the Jordan River. You about to get smoked, okay? Because I know what happens when my God goes first. Everybody goes down. That's what we're supposed to learn from this idea of, yes, notice that I'm with you, but notice what's going to be true later, because it's me. That's what God is saying there. God has been faithful, and God will be faithful. And the path to our promise is in the pattern. Remember the pattern? Remember what we said it was? It was like, oh my gosh, this is so hard, this is impossible, but I'm going to trust God and obey. Boom! I'm out! That was awesome! And then it's going to happen again. Oh, how did I get here? Why am I here again? Oh, this is so hard, what's going to happen? I'm going to go ahead and obey and walk in faith. Boom! I'm out! Now, it's up to God when that boom happens, but it does happen. And here's what God doesn't do. He doesn't necessarily tell you everything that's going to happen before that boom. He doesn't tell you the way, because some of us are so smart / not smart that we're trying to figure God out. We're trying to figure out, now, how's he going to do it? And you've got 12 different little diagrams of how God might do it. And God's like, dude, I'm not telling you. And by the way, I don't have to tell you. Like, I'm going to bring stuff at the last minute that you couldn't see coming, that you couldn't do anything about. And then I'm going to bring the breakthrough. Here it is, verse 15. It was harvest season, and the Jordan was overflowing its banks, but as soon as the feet of the priests were carrying the ark touched the water at the river's edge, the water above that point began backing up a great distance away at a town called Adam. By the way, that's where we get Adam, which is near Zarethan, and the water below that point flowed onto the Dead Sea until the riverbed was dry. Then all the people crossed over to the town of Jericho. Oh my gosh, it's impossible. I'm going to go ahead and obey and trust God. Boom, I'm out. That's the pattern. And we attain the promise by following the pattern. Here's two reminders when we want to foster hope, and everybody needs hope. So here's two reminders that we need to remember. Number one, God has been faithful. That's what they needed to remember. That's what we need to remember. All they need to do is look back. Remember? God was the faithful God that got you out of that bondage. God was the one who got you through all of your tests. You didn't necessarily pass them all very well, but God still got you through them. God has been faithful to you, Israelites, and God will be faithful to us as we go ahead and trust him. He was also faithful even in this little dark moment when people totally distrusted the Lord and then got 40 years in the desert. I want you to hear what God says. He said this in Numbers 14:29 to the parents of the generation that's going across right now. He says, "You will all drop dead in this wilderness because you've complained against me. Every one of you who is 20 years old or older and was included in the registration will die." How's that for a prophecy? How'd you like to get that from the Lord? Here's what I want you to do on all your Christmas cards, or, you know, when you're sending somebody a little sweet encouragement, go ahead and put Numbers 14:29 at the end. Just be like, "Be blessed, Numbers 14:29." See if they read it. See what happens. Hey, so they'd faced barriers of the past, and God was faithful. You and I face barriers, don't we? We face hard stuff that we don't know how we're going to get out of. Maybe you're facing a strained marriage. Maybe you're facing unemployment. Maybe you're facing one of my loved ones seems to be getting sicker and sicker, and I don't know what to do. Maybe you've got this barrier in your mind. You always feel like you're falling behind. You always feel like you're never going to be able to pull ahead. Maybe you feel like you've made some decisions that have caused your career to be dead. Maybe you've just done dumb stuff with money. How many know about that test? Like, I had money, and then I was dumb. Maybe that's your barrier, and it's hard to get past that thing. But as we said, when we're at the edge of the Jordan, we are on the brink of a breakthrough. We've seen this in our church. Do you know that our church has faced barriers in the past? So there was a barrier back in the day. Those of the Torch heritage may remember back in the movie theater days, we were a portable church in a movie theater, and we were running out of space in the theater that we were in. And people were looking to me to try to get us a larger theater, and there was a larger theater, so I went to the manager. I'm like, "Hey, man, look, what do we got to do? How do we get this big theater?" And I would go again and again. He was just getting tired of me. He's like, "Dude, I'm telling you, there's nothing you can do. You cannot have this theater." And so then some sweet little saints come up to me, and they're like, "I'll tell you what we got to do, Carter. We got to pray. We got to pray for God to do it." And I'm like, "Whatever, you pray. Like, go ahead. I'm not going to stop. I'm the pastor. What am I going to say? Don't pray. Like, go ahead, but it's not going to work. Like, this isn't going to happen." And then they went and prayed, and then it happened. And then, he came to me and was like, "Hey, man, you guys can just have it." And I was like, "Oh, my word." That was an impossible barrier that faith crossed over. Faith and obedience, because they prayed, crossed over. For those maybe of the faith heritage, you remember when senior pastor Zach informed everybody, "Hey, I'm retiring. I've got to go. This is going to be a barrier. We don't know what's going to happen on the other end." We had yet to see how that was going to work out. Some might remember when we decided to bring two church families together, this whole merge process. And man, I got to tell you, that was a barrier. Like, for those who don't know, that happened in 2015 and 2016. And that was hard. That was, for me, as I'm looking at things, I'm up against the edge of this Jordan. I'm like, "I don't know, Lord. I don't know if we should do this. This is hard. This is painful. I don't know if there's really a promised land on the other side of this. There might just be me dying in the middle of the Jordan. I don't know how this is going to work." And now we look back and we say, "Oh, God was faithful." Because actually the whole thing worked. Like, God brought along two families and put them together. And now, it's amazing. Like, it's awesome. In fact, when I look back at how hard that was, I can't believe how awesome it is now. I'm like, "Dude, this is terrific. This is wonderful. I'm so glad that we decided to go forth into what God was calling us to do." I think of some other things where God has been faithful. So one day, my wife came up to me and says, I feel like we need to have a women's conference. I'm like, all right, honey, hey, that's cool. I don't know what you're going to do. If you guys are going to knit or like drink tea. I don't know what ladies do. Hey, that's great. You know, why don't you assemble a team and go do it? It was very hands-off. Guys, I look at Sword Girl right now, and it's one of those things, I don't understand how this is happening, okay? Because the amount of energy we put into it, it's significant, but how fruitful it is severely disproportionate to what we invest in it. And that's not how it's worked at our church, okay? So let me just tell us a little bit. We've poured a whole lot more energy into things that worked half as well. And yet this is a situation where we say, dude, this is just God. This God has been faithful. God is doing this. I don't understand this. I look at this event that we have in the summer called The Wave. In 2016, a group of us just said, hey, what would it be like if we just sent our students to this water park conference where we preach the gospel to them? It'd be a little bit more expensive. It's far away. I don't know if parents will let us do it. And we're like, who knows? And we did it. And my friends, it blew up and it was amazing. It was one of those moments that could only be God. And just like God was faithful in the past, God will be faithful in the future. What do we need to do it? We've been mentioning it. Here's what we need. We need consecration and faith, obedience and faith, purity and faith. That was the recipe that we just saw with these people. Verse 5, Joshua told the people, purify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do great wonders among you. Many of your translations probably say, consecrate yourself. And it was about purity, but really consecration was, I'm going to wash myself on the outside to demonstrate a desire for inward cleansing on the inside. I'm going to wash myself on the outside so I can demonstrate my hunger to get closer to God. And so that's what they did. They had to say, hey, I want to be for real with God before we get up to the edge of this Jordan. And my friends, that's what he challenges us to do. He says, look, there's places in your life where you don't have any integrity. You've lost some of your purity. You're not really walking in obedience. And then you try, you're trying to cross this Jordan. You're like, I'm going to get a running start, you know? And then you're like, and you can't get through because God says, purify yourself, cleanse yourself. And here's why, because my precious, there's things that can't go into the promised land that are from Egypt. There's things you did in Egypt, okay, when you were young, and even when you got saved and came out, okay, and you had some little patterns that you kind of nursed, and they weren't really good, and God was patient with them for a while, and you know, until you were a toddler, until finally he said, listen, man, for you to get across that river, you got to let that stuff go, because Egyptian stuff doesn't live in the promised land, and I can't let you bring it with. You'll mess up the promised land. So you got to die to that stuff. You got to become a person concerned with inward integrity. That means an integrated life. That means my life comes together. What I say is about the same as what I do. Who I present to folks is really who I am when no one's even around. That's integrity that the Lord is trying to grow us through. And he says, I'm sorry, you're not going to make the jump over Jordan. You can't make it until you purify yourself to get past that barrier. So we got to do whatever it takes. So proud of my friend Jonathan Lozada. You guys, you've seen him up here rapping, right? He's the dude. He'll get up and he wears all white and it's like super cool. I'm like, man, I want to be like that dude. Well, he was sharing with a group of us about just a work trial that he had recently. It's one of those situations where, and I've experienced this, so you may speculate if this is really real, but I really believe it was real. When you just have a boss that is just after you, man, like they want to get you fired. You got this manager that is just, they're making you not get the benefits when other folks, because for some reason they just don't like you. Well, Jonathan was experiencing some of this. And he didn't know what to do. He was having all the same reactions that you and I would have. I mean, you can only get ragged on so long before he's like, I'll tell you what I'm gonna do. I'm just gonna punch him and quit. And yet, he's like, man, I'm a Christ follower, so I gotta do something different than that. And so he got concerned in two areas, and these are the areas we need to be worried about. He got concerned about the exterior, but also the interior man. He was concerned with the exterior saying, okay, I am not going to punch him. Like that was the action. That was the behavior. I refuse to be punching people. Okay. But then there's the internal fight. And the internal fight was not only that, I'm not going to defend myself. I'm going to let God defend me and I'm going to pray for my enemies. Boom. Dude, you want to jump across the Jordan quickly. Like you get that test right. Well, what happened ended up The union got involved and totally defended Jonathan, and everything worked out all right, and he kept his integrity. My friends, you don't think God's going to find a way to reward that? I mean, that's just how he works. And every one of us, we need to be worried about the external, but also the internal. Do we have an integrated life that we could say, I'm not perfect, but through Christ, I'm doing my best to put to death the old man or woman, to put to death the things of the flesh so that Christ can live in me. Come on, somebody. You can say amen. I know it's hot. You can say hot amen, however you say it. Hey, so we need that purity, but we also need faith. We need faith to do the next step that we understand. You don't need to know everything. We are on a need-to-know basis with God, just so we're clear about that. We don't need to know everything, but we need to do what we know. And he only gave them one step. He said, as soon as the feet of the priests were carrying the ark touched the water, as soon as, can you imagine it? Like, boop, and then it starts. This water starts to separate. They only needed to follow the one step, but they did need to get their toes wet. And my friends, maybe God is waiting on you and me. Dude, just put a foot in the water. Just do what you know. Don't figure it out. Do what you know and see what I will do. See, faith isn't really the absence of crisis. We've all got crisis, man. The river looks like a crisis. Faith isn't the absence of crisis. It's the presence of Christ in the crisis. That's what it is. It says, it doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter if it's a river. It doesn't matter if it's a trickle. It doesn't matter if it's a Red Sea. All that matters is that God is with me and God is powerful. And every one of us is going to have to remember, I've got to trust God sometimes just to get across this thing. It's scary. I don't know what's going to happen. There was a masterpiece released into the cinema in 1989 called Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. And Indiana faces this tough faith test. Now, he's not particularly a man of faith, but let's watch how he passes this faith test.
Impossible. Nobody can jump this.
Indy! Indy, you must hurry! Come quickly!
It's a leap of faith.
Lord, you must believe, boy. Must believe.
They make them like that anymore? I don't know if they do. But you can see Indy's predicament, man. Like so many of us, I want to walk by faith, but I keep trying to walk by sight. It's not that the bridge wasn't there. It's just that he couldn't see it. And that's how God works with us so often. He's like, I see all kinds of things that you don't see, but I'm not going to tell you. I just want you to take my word for it and walk by faith. Can I tell you my fear as a pastor of this church? My fear as a pastor of this church is that I will live and die in a completely explainable church. Meaning the only stuff that happens here was stuff that you could have just been any organization and it would have happened anyway. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you move people around and you do projects and you do all that stuff, but there was nothing that was God-kissed. There was nothing that was God-sent. I need to be one of those guys that is in a church that sees God move in ways that could only be God. So whether it's Sword Girl, whether it's The Wave, whatever it is, I need to see things that are only God. And I'm afraid of that. Can I tell you the prayer that I'm afraid to pray? That I feel like I'm supposed to pray? I feel as the Lord is telling me, I want you to pray to reach 10,000. Now, that might just sound like dumb ambition to you. I'm just telling you, I don't have that. You know what I'm saying? I don't think I'm that kind of leader. I don't think that's who I am. I don't think I can do that. And yet, I feel directed that I'm supposed to do that. I don't believe I could do that. And quite frankly, I don't believe we could do it. I don't believe you could do it. But I believe God could do it. If God wanted to do it, he could part that Jordan. If God wanted to do it, he could do it. And I think the only missing step is you and I praying for it. So here's what I want to challenge you to do. I want you to join me in my scary faith test. I want you to get out your phone, and I want you to, at 10 a.m. every day for the next year, I want you to pray, Lord, help us reach 10,000. And we'll all just pray it. You maybe put it on vibrate in case you're in a meeting or in someplace weird. But it will still vibrate. It will tell you, hey, pray for 10,000. Does that sound like a deal? Let's do it, man. Hey, we might as well. We're here. We might as well do it. Maybe for you, there's a little more personal dream that you need to have faith about. Maybe you need to keep developing yourself because you're like, I feel like life is passing me by and people are accelerating ahead of me. Maybe your faith step is to keep developing yourself. Maybe your faith step is to go see a counselor because you've been feeling the pull to do it, but you haven't done it and you just know, I just need to do it. So God has been faithful and God will be faithful. God, my friends, listen, we're almost there. God will be faithful to you. God will be just like he's faithful now. Think about the things in the future. They're like, wow, I wonder how that's going to go. I can tell you how it's going to go. God is going to be faithful. That's how it's going to go. Whatever happens for you, whatever's happening with the boss, whatever's happening with the job, whatever's happening with the money, whatever's happening with your family, whatever's happening with the relationship that you're trying to get out of or trying to get into, whatever happens with the church that you're at, whatever happens, here's what I know. God is going to be faithful to you. That's what he's going to do. He can't do anything else. So, dude, you can just write it down. I don't even know what it is, but I know God is going to be faithful to me. He can't not. Just like he parted the waters before, he will part the waters again. That's what he does. He's in the faithfulness business, and his faithfulness today foretells his faithfulness in the future. That's how it works, yo. That's it. What we've got to do in the meantime, as a church, we've got to maximize the space. We know the direction we're supposed to go. So we've got to maximize the space. We've got to do all this for those to come stuff that we talked about in the fall. We got to make this space the awesomest space we can possibly make it to house God's people and to house his presence. That's what we've got to do. But it's not the only thing that we've got to do. We've got to keep going digital. You want to know where we're going to put our faith? We're going to keep building our steps into the Jordan. We're going to keep finding ways to do digital ministry. It doesn't mean we'll stop doing this, but just like you've got the Tuesday at noon digital prayer meeting, we know that people are on their phones and tablets. We need to get discipleship into those places. And so whatever we're going to do, we're going to do those things. But then we even need to do more. We need to take those who are true, honest seekers of living water, of the Word of God and the Spirit of God, and we need to mobilize them. And my friends, we need to send out little torches into all the areas of darkness around us that the Lord opens up doors. We need to do it because there's a lost and dying world. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to plan on it, not knowing exactly how. We're just going to push. We're just going to walk toward the water. We're just going to go that way, not knowing what God will do. But here's what we know. The God who's faithful today is going to be faithful in the future, just like he was faithful in the past. My friends, that's the God we have, and that's the confidence you and I are supposed to have. So who's going to do it? Who's with me, man? We going to do this thing or what? See, here's where we get to it. The question isn't really, is God going to be faithful? The question is, are we? Are we going to be faithful with what we've been given? You have some faith. Do not stop here. We need to keep going. And this is what Jesus wondered while he was on earth. You want to know what was on his mind? Luke 18:8. But when the Son of Man returns, how many will he find on the earth who have faith? He's like, you know, when I get back here, I wonder who's going to just keep on believing. Who, like, you know, the world hasn't torn them down with cynicism. They don't know how God's going to do everything, but they're like, I don't know. Don't ask me because I don't know. All I know is this. I'm believing God. I'm believing him even though I don't see what he's going to do or how he's going to do it. Jesus, for you and for me, faced barriers. He faced barriers of rejection, scorn, pain, misunderstanding, abandonment of his family, of his friends. He was then beaten, flogged, and crucified naked until he was dead. And he saw it coming. He saw that Jordan coming. He was coming up to the edge of it. And he says, Father, shall I ask for you to take this cup from me? It was for this cup that I was born. Father, glorify your name. And he embraced his Jordan. And because he embraced his Jordan, he went across and he left us a pattern. Do you see the pattern? The pattern, in case you can't see this far, is the cross. The cross is the pattern that takes us to the promise. And Jesus was confident in you and me. He didn't just believe, hey, when I get across, it'll be good. He says, I will leave a way that anyone who comes after me, if they will pick up their cross and follow me, they'll really be my disciples. And my friends, here's the power. Whatever you and I are going through, like whatever the situation is, we're like, man, how do I get along with God's will? How do I keep going? Even if it's mundane, even if I've got a great challenge, how do I do this? And Jesus says, look at the pattern again. Look at the pattern again. You're going to be in this great, difficult experience, and you're going to decide to believe and decide to obey. But it's only because, it's not because you followed the recipe. It's only because of my blood and because you embrace the way of the cross that you're going to make it across. So what do you do about that marriage? Embrace the way of the cross. What do you do about that coworker that you're having difficulty with? Embrace the way of the cross. Die to yourself. Die to your selfishness. Die to the thing that you want. Now, you don't have to, but you have to if you want to go the Jesus way. Because Jesus left the pattern that leads to the promise, and he did it for you with confidence that because he did it, you and I can do it too. Dear heart, Jesus is going to be faithful to you. You need to keep going. Don't you dare quit. Now is the time. This is your chance to be faithful because the faithful one was faithful to you. Let's bow our heads and let's take this land. Hey, Jesus, we just want to thank you so much for your determination to make it over Jordan. Thank you that you did it knowing you were bringing us with you. And Lord, now we pray, whatever our situation is, we've got Jordans, and some of them are, man, they're really tender in our hearts because they hurt. We want to ask for your mercy, your power, and your help to be faithful, to be full of faith, and to just obey the step that we know. And if we don't know any step, help us to obey by waiting on the Lord and being faithful to listen for your voice. Hey God, help us to reach 10,000 and help us to be a church that is not so much confident in itself, but confident that the God who's been faithful in the past and today will be faithful in the future. In Christ's name. Amen.